Hello everyone, I'm Himani Joshi. I'm a PhD student at IIIT Delhi, India. In this presentation, I'm going to present my work that is accepted in ICAST 2020 conference. The title of my presentation is Low-Rate Intelligent Non-Contiguous Wideband Angular Sensing. The existing work that has been done in wideband angular spectrum sensing utilizes the sub-Nyquist sampling technique, which allows the digitization at rate much lower than the Nyquist rate. However, these methods suffers from two major limitations. One is they perform sensing over the entire wideband spectrum, which is not desired as some of the frequency bands like Wi-Fi band or radar band and license band cannot be accessed due to high traffic and security constraints. Furthermore, these architecture depends on the number of transmissions. So it causes sensing failure whenever the number of transmission is higher than the number of active antennas. So there is a need of a reconfigurable architecture that can work independent of the number of transmission. Further, there is a need of intelligent sensing which can perform sensing over the desired frequency bands in the wideband spectrum. So we have proposed an intelligent wideband angular spectrum sensing method where the output of the antenna is passed to the non-contiguous sub-Nyquist sampling block, which digitizes only selected frequency bands whose indexes are stored in vector beta. So these digitized beta frequency bands are passed to joint angular frequency estimation block, whose task is to determine the KG frequency and direction of arrival of BC frequency bands present in beta, and the occupancy status of these beta frequency bands is then passed to the learning and decision making block, which performs the learning of all the frequency bands. It learns the spectrum statistics of all the frequency bands and determine the optimum value of beta so that sensing failure won't happen and the throughput is maximum. With throughput refers to the number of beacon frequency bands present in the sensed spectrum. Here we consider the traditional signal model for our work, where we consider wideband signal. The aim denotes the narrowband signal, which is uncorrelated and far field. The point to be note here is that the M, that is the number of active transmission, is unknown in our case. We assume that the entire frequency range is divided into n number of frequency bands, each of bandwidth B hertz, and the occupancy status, like the BC status of these bands, depends upon the Markovian decision process, which has two states, BC and vacant, and the occupancy of these frequency bands depends upon the transition probability between these vacant and BC states. Now we'll discuss every block of the proposed method. First block is the non-contiguous sub-Nyquist sampling block. Here we consider sparse antenna array. So the minimum sparse ruler of length L is used, where LS is the actual number of antenna. Each antenna has two branches. One is the direct branch, another is the delayed branch. So the branch that we can see, this is the direct branch, and the branch which is having delay element is the delayed branch. Considering the case of direct branch, the output is passed to the mixer, where we multiply the incoming signal with a mixing function. And this mixing function here, we can see that it brings down all the beta frequency bands to the baseband level. So here we are multiplying. In order to have better visualization, we take the Fourier transform of the mixer output. Let's say the plot A, if the plot A is my entire wideband, which is divided into five number of frequency bands, out of which, for example, we are sensing four frequency bands that are stored in beta, that is the frequency band 1, frequency band 2, frequency band 3, frequency band 4 and 5. So out of these five, we have three active transmission, and out of three active transmission, we are sensing only two active transmission, that is the yellow one and the red one. The second term in this Fourier transform is shown in B, C and D. for these three active transmissions, that is m equals to 1, as we have two transmissions, so this capital M is 3, and we have three curves for the second term. Here, and last plot, that is E, is the summation of all the plot B, C, and D. So YLF is figure number E. Here we can observe that only the active transmissions that are present in beta, that is the yellow one and the red one, are at the baseband level, that is in the frequency range 0 to B. So we filter out this frequency band by applying low pass filter over 0 to B frequency range. And here we observe that the output ZLF is the summation of the steering vector and the corresponding active transmission at baseband. When we in the matrix form, we can write the output of ADCs for direct and delayed branch as shown in these three equations, where Zn is the output of ADC and Zdn is the output of ADC of delayed branch. S is a steering matrix and A is the baseband of active transmissions present in beta frequency bands, and the D is the diagonal matrix containing the delay for every frequency band. Now the samples Zn and Zdn are passed to a joint angular frequency estimation block, where we first take the covariance matrix, which in the noise-free scenario can be written as this. Here these two matrix RAA and RAAD are the diagonal matrix. So here we apply the Kronecker and Khatri-Rao property of vectorization to get these two equations, and by removing the redundant entries and applying the spatial smoothing, we get the matrix RSS and RSSD as shown in these two equations. Now, in order to find the carrier frequency, we form a autocorrelation matrix R1, which is the autocorrelation of RSS matrix, and second matrix R2, that is the cross correlation of RSS and RSSD. Now, we determine the generalized eigenvalue for R1 and R2, and with the help of those generalized eigenvalues, which is stored in lambda b, we can determine the carrier frequency of B frequency bands, that is the active transmission bands present in beta. And to determine the corresponding DOA, we apply music algorithm for each carrier frequency. However, we need to determine beta, that is the bands we need to be sensed. So for that, we are using learning and decision making block. So the task of learning and decision making block is to learn the transition probability, that is the probability of going from one state to another, that is the vacant and busy states, and to determine the optimum value of beta, and the beta, that is the bands that we are going to sense, and mod beta, that is how many number of bands we need to sense such that sensing failure does not occur. And sensing failure occurs whenever the number of active transmission in S beta, that is the bands that which we are sensing, is higher than L minus 1, that is the number of antennas. Otherwise, if this condition is not met, then we have zero sensing failure. Here we, in learning decision making block, we utilize one more terminology, that is the immediate probability of vacancy vector, and this vector is updated at every time slot for all the frequency bands. So for the Bth frequency band, it is equals to the probability of going from BC to vacant state, that is probability of 1 to 0 whenever the detected frequency band is BZ for the current time slot, and it is equals to probability of going from vacant to vacant transition, that is probability of 0 to 0 whenever the detected band is vacant at particular time slot. And if the band is not sensed in that particular time slot, or if sensing failure occurs, then its immediate probability of vacancy is determined based upon its previous value, that is the phi. Now here, for learning decision making, we are using the proposed wide band upper confidence bound algorithm. which for the initial time slot sequentially senses all the n frequency bands in a group of L minus 1 bands. So the L minus 1 bands is selected because it does not allow sensing failure. So once all the n frequency bands are sensed once, then for the rest of the time slot TS, we select beta frequency bands based upon the transitional quality index QT. Here in the second term, VTSB denotes the number of times P frequency band is sensed. So, and delta is the exploration coefficient. So when we sense a particular frequency band for sufficient number of times, then this contribution of second terms, the second terms becomes almost negligible. And in that case, the transition quality index becomes almost same as the immediate probability of vacancy for that frequency band. So now it's clear that for rest of the time slot, we select the frequency band based upon the transition quality index. But how many bands we should sense? For that, we define two vectors, gamma 1 and gamma 2, which consist of L minus 1 bands, where the gamma 1 consists of L minus 1 bands corresponding to the highest value of psi, that is the probability of immediate probability of vacancy, and gamma 2 consists of L minus 1 bands of highest value of quality index. When both the gamma 1 and gamma 2 converges, that is, if both L minus 1 bands for both gamma 1 and gamma 2 are same, then it means that we now learning is sufficient and we can sense as high number of bands as possible, and we select gamma B by maximizing the throughput, which is denoted as this one. And if it doesn't converge, then we keep on sensing L minus 1 frequency bands, which avoids the sensing, in order to avoid the sensing failure. Now for the simulation results, we have done the comparison of the proposed method that is termed here as intelligent ultra wideband angular sensing, IUWAS, and contiguous wideband angular sensing, where we don't apply learning and decision making. We just sense the entire wideband spectrum as with the architecture shown previously. And then we compared these two methods with cascade method, which is a state of art method to perform sub-Nyquist sampling based wideband angular sensing. In this plot, we are showing the result for normalized carrier frequency estimation error. Here we consider the scenario where we have 16 number of frequency bands and LS is 4. Therefore the number of active and therefore the number of antennas, possible antennas, will be 6. And for the pair comparison, we consider cascade algorithm with 7 antennas. But with 7 antenna, the cascade algorithm can sense only 3 occupied bands, whereas the proposed architecture can sense 5 occupied bands. Due to this reason, the cascade algorithm, that is the red graph, has the highest error as compared to other two. And since the blue curve, that is the proposed method with intelligence, is avoids the sensing failure, so the as compared to the green curve, so the error in carrier frequency is minimum for the proposed IUWAS. Similarly, we find the first graph here is the normalized TO estimation error, and here we observe the same trend where the proposed method with intelligence is having minimum error as compared to other two methods. And in the same way, the throughput, that is the number of vacant frequency band in spatial domain, is maximum for the proposed method, which is having intelligence. Then the proposed architecture without any intelligence, that is no learning and decision making algorithm, we are performing sensing over the entire band, and the minimum throughput is observed for the cascade algorithm. So the conclusion of the presentation is, we have proposed a low rate intelligent non-contiguous wideband angular sensing framework. Here we developed the sparse antenna array architecture, which digitizes only a set of frequency bands determined by the proposed learning and decision making algorithm. And because of the non-contiguous wideband angular sensing, the proposed learning based method does not face any sensing failure and thus outperforms the existing methods. Thank you. Thank you. If you have any question, then you can contact me over this email ID. Thank you.